That's what happens.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi.
And welcome to Assembly. So today, it is my pleasure to introduce our distinguished speaker. So Grammy-nominated singer-songwriter PerlaBatalla is celebrated for her unique voice, heartfelt lyrics, and culturally diverse compositions. Born in Los Angeles to a musically immersed family, her father, a Mexican mariachi and DJ, and her Argentine mother, who ran a family record shop, Discoteca Batalla, provided Perla with a rich musical education spanning genres and languages. After collaborating with various groups, including legendary Leonard Cohen, Perla embarked on a solo career with Cohen's encouragement. Over the years, she has released 7 albums, graced the screens of film and TV, presented 2 one-woman shows, and performed in renowned venues worldwide. Beyond her musical accomplishments, Perla is dedicated to exposing youth to the beauty of music and the Spanish language. Her outreach efforts extend to some of the most economically challenged communities in the U.S. Recognizing her extraordinary commitment to social and economic justice, Perla has received 2 UN awards, the Earth Charter Award and the Environmental Peacebuilding Award. Her musical contributions to advancing social justice has also earned her New Mexico's prestigious Premio Fronterizo Award. And without further ado, PerlaBatalla.
Are you good to start the film?
Yep.
All right. This will be a collection of some different performances Perla's done over the last many years.
First of its kind, all Latino record store on the border between Venice and Santa Monica. And that's where she would hear the music that would change her life. She started doing gigs all around town, and before you knew it, she was backing some of the most famous singers around, including Leonard Cohen, who encouraged her to go out on her own, and she did. Since then, she has received Grammy nominations, 2 awards from the UN, the first one being the Earth Charter Award for Extraordinary Devotion to Social Justice. The second, the Environmental Peacebuilding Award for Advancing Social Justice Through Music. She continues to travel the world, spreading the stories of the family record store, La Discoteca Batalla. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my pleasure to introduce to you the incredibly talented and the best sister that a brother could have, PerlaBatalla. Gracias a la vida que me ha dado tanto, me dio dos luces, y cuando los abro, perfecto distingo, lo negro del blanco, y en el alto cielo, supongo estrellado.
I have tried
Lean that way forever. coming to the USA.
We asked for signs. The signs were sent. The birth betrayed. The marriage spent. The signs for all to see. I can remember with that lawless crowd, while the killers in high places say their prayers aloud. But they summoned up a thunder cloud. They're gonna hear from me.
Choosing music as my career. and it all started with the junior high, actually, because I had one of the best music teachers, I think, that ever existed. Also, part of our, back then, part of our public school system was that we had great arts and great music in our schools, in our public schools. Nowadays, I don't think that's the case anymore, very sadly, but I also think that that's why this particular school has a very special place in my heart, because artists and those brave enough to choose that for your life, I bow down to you. It's a very courageous choice. It's certainly not easy, and I think you have to do it for the right reasons. Many people that I've talked to have said, you know, I want to be successful. And I always think that's a very interesting question, because what is success? Is if you choose it as fame and money, for me, that's a shallow, reason. That's not... because I've known so many people that have been very successful in that way. Fame, money, doesn't necessarily make you happy. And I think a far more important motive for doing this is the art itself and the work itself. If you think about what you do in terms of, I'm doing this in the best possible way that I can, then I think that is successful. For me, success has always meant doing a good job at what I do, getting to the heart of a matter, you know, just digging deep and finding the deepest truth that you can find and expressing that. You don't have to be the best singer in the room. You don't have to be the best artist in the studio. You don't have to be the best rapper. If you are telling the truth, and it's your truth, I think you can move people. And that's always been the goal, is to tell the truth in a way that moves people, for me anyway. So I've had the great, great luck of working with artists such as Leonard Cohen, who is maybe one of the best writers. I mean, poets that ever existed. And the fact that that this lucky thing happened, that I could sing with him, changed my life forever. And I'm going to back up a little bit, because it sort of started with a not so happy event. I'd been singing in, you know, clubs and learning my stuff, singing with jazz groups and just singing very intricate lyrics with harmonies, and that was a really great training ground for me, especially for becoming a backing vocalist. It's a real art in itself, being a backing vocalist, especially for really great music like Leonard Cohen's. And I have to credit learning all that great classical music when I was young, and then learning jazz, and then learning chordal structures, and all that sort of led me to this place. So I got my first big break. A famous rock star, I won't tell you who it is, but got this gig, and we started to rehearse. And I was taken aback with how loud everything was. Before that, I was just used to being able to hear everything, and pitches were easy to come by, and everything was just beautifully perfect in my jazz world. But I get into the rock and roll world, and all of a sudden, it's really loud. So loud that I just can't hear anything. I'm not singing my best. I'm not singing on pitch. I got fired from this gig. After our first big gig, I got fired. I was devastated. I thought, I will never, ever sing again. I'm going to find another job, because I can't take it. It was so, so painful. I was so ashamed. I was so embarrassed. And I was crying. I called my dad, and I was just crying and said, I just don't ever want to do this again. I hate everybody. And my dad, who was never someone to give me advice, never a calming figure in my life ever. My dad was kind of a scary person. But he was the only one there when I called my mom, so I just had to talk to him. And he said to me, you know, calm down. I have this feeling that something really great is going to happen for you very soon. My dad has never said anything like that to me in my life. And I kind of calmed down, took a deep breath, and was shocked, mainly. And I got off the phone, and I swear, moments later, the phone rang again, and I thought, well, it's my mom calling me, because she heard about how upset I was. And it's somebody called Roscoe Beck who said, oh, you know, we're auditioning singers for Leonard Cohen, and you might be, your name came up, I hope you're interested in coming to audition. And I said, sure. And I got off the phone and my first thought was, who's Leonard Cohen? I didn't know really much about him, so I ran to, you know, Tower Records on Sunset, where we used to buy all of our cassettes and records and CDs, and I found everything I could find on Leonard Cohen, and I brought it home, and I listened to this music, and my whole world opened up. Not only because, you know, he's kind of a scruffy singer, he doesn't think he's a singer, but I think he's a great singer for all those reasons that I've mentioned. He's honest, and those lyrics are his, so it's deep, they're beautiful, and it constantly has new meaning. When you evolve, Leonard Cohen's lyrics evolve as well. So I was blown away by this stuff and thought, wow, it'd be really fun to be able to sing these songs with him. And so I listened to the music and I thought, what's the most important thing about my audition tomorrow? What is the most important decision that I have to make about tomorrow? And it came to me, what am I going to wear? I thought, first impressions, all that, it's important. So I listened to the lyrics, I let the lyrics dictate what I would put on for this first impression at my audition. And I arrived at the studio and Roscoe Beck, the musical director, said, Perla, let's just meet first. Leonard's going to come out and say hello before you walk in for the audition. And I said, okay. And I see this figure walking toward me, and it's kind of not a very tall man. He's wearing an Armani suit, and he's dressed all in black from head to toe. And I am dressed all in white from head to toe. And as he walks toward me, he starts to giggle, and he takes my hand in his, and he says, darling, this is a match made in heaven. And I got the gig, and I had to learn 3 hours worth of material in a very, very short time, because they'd been rehearsing already for weeks before I showed up. They couldn't find that last singer. So I learned the material. I was absolutely astounded by the quality of this work, and then I got to travel the world. It was the first time I had ever been to Europe, and London, and all these wonderful places, and I didn't even have a passport. Like, I had to go get a passport so I could do this trip. But for me, and then Leonard and I became really close friends, and until the day he died, he was always inspiring me to continue on my path, because he knew that my path was my very own. It wasn't dictated by anyone else. I didn't want what everyone else wanted. I wanted a family. I wanted kind of a life that's full of art and beauty. I wanted to sing, not only sing backup, I wanted to sing solo. He totally supported that. And I also wanted to have the respect of my peers. I know a lot of people say, I don't care what anybody else thinks, but my peers, my respected peers, I want them to respect what I do. And I have all those things. So to me, that is what success is. And and I've been supporting myself as a singer my entire adult life. But those aren't, you know, it's not just about music for me. It's about art. I taught my daughter early on, you know, draw, paint, do all those things, because they will bring you joy and they will be your friend when you don't feel like you have any friends. Art, music, all those things. So a life full of those things will give you a foundation. And for me, that's what those things have done. And I feel very, very, very lucky that I had such a good start, you know, in school with my teachers who were so, so giving. And so to this day, I love classical music. I love music of every possible kind. I listen to everything. I try to listen to what the newest stuff is that's out there. Not just classical, but pop, rap, you know, funk, everything. I just feel very lucky that I've been, you know, it's not just about doing the work, establishing yourself as an artist, but it's also about, you know, those chances you get, those lucky chances you get, and when to say yes and when to say no. I mean, it's some things you do need to say no to, but, and it's not just about the money. You know, I know we all need a gig and we all need to get paid, but it's very important that you also know that it's okay to say no to some things. I know that Michaela wanted me to open this up to any questions. You can turn up the lights a little bit so we can see each other. Yes. Does anyone have a question? Sorry? Yes.
So I noticed in some of the videos that you were barefoot. Do you?
Yes.
Is that like for the music or just your shoes?
Yeah, you know, it's funny. I used to have to wear heels a lot in the jazz days when I was doing my jazz gigs. And then when I got to perform as a solo artist, I loved, and also, I mean, I did this in my early training where my vocal coach always said to have my feet firmly planted on the floor. And it wasn't just to hold myself up, but it was just to feel the energy of the earth and everything that's come before you, and it really helped. So when I was, you know, able to do whatever I wanted as a solo artist, I do not wear shoes most of the time, and it's really, it's very freeing. So yeah, I love that. Anybody else? So most of you here, are you music students? Are there music students here? Can I see hands? How many music? Okay, so there's a lot of you vocal art. Are you singers, writers? Okay, visual artists? Okay, quite a lot of those too. Photography? Okay, that was one of my careers when I was 19. I was lost as can be, out of high school, no job, and then because I grew up in Santa Monica, one of my friends said to me, what are you going to do after graduation? And I was like, I don't know. I wanted to go to college and study opera, but I couldn't afford that, so I had to get a job. And my friend said, oh, well, you know, Norman Lear is hiring people for his business company or whatever. So I went and worked for Norman Lear, who's a TV producer who just recently passed away, and wonderful human being. And I worked in the publicity department, and all of a sudden, they had 10 hit television shows. Like, all of a sudden. They'd had a few before, but now they had 10 on the top 10. So my boss says to me, do you want to become a photographer? I had never in my life shot a camera before, like a 35 millimeter camera. But I said, of course I would love to do it. And over the weekend, I learned how to shoot film, and with a lot of help from the photographer who worked there, was very kind to me, I shot all the stills for the shows, and within like 2 years, I became an executive photographer for Norman Lear and the head of the photo department. Still singing 5 nights a week, because it was, the music was very important to me, and I didn't want to give that up. So yeah, photography is also one of my, that wasn't necessarily creative photography, but it did trigger this love of photography for me forever. Anybody have, just, yes.
What's the best location or like your favorite location you performed at?
Gosh, Carnegie Hall. Mm. Yeah, Carnegie Hall is spectacular. Mm. I sang there with Leonard Cohen, and it was funny because it was in the early days of Carnegie Hall allowing, amplified music. Because we had a band and we had gear and we had all that stuff, and they were very nervous about it. But Leonard liked to pride himself in being that we were the quietest band that ever existed. And it's true, we were very quiet. All the levels were very, very low, so everybody could hear everything in the room. We didn't have to depend on monitors, which is a luxury. Because, please, those of you in the music field, watch your ears, protect your ears. Seriously. I have been protecting my ears my whole life. It's a miracle that I have such, still such great hearing. Because there's sometimes you can't avoid feedback or things that are going to hurt you. But for the most part, if you're going to listen to music, wear earplugs. Go when you're at concerts, wear earplugs. Protect your hearing, because once it's gone, it's not coming back. Anyone else? Yeah.
Oh, you go.
Did you have a question?
Oh. Oh, go ahead.
Go ahead.
Go for it, Mara.
Anybody?
Favorite thing about music, just in general.
I think my favorite thing about any art is when it just moves you. Like, I'll be watching something and I'll just burst into tears with how beautiful something is. My family teases me about how when something is beautiful, I just burst into tears. Now that, at my age, I'm not embarrassed. I will just go ahead. I will go for it. And that means it's good. It's good work if I feel like that. Claudia?
A couple people.
Yeah.
Oh, I was wondering, how do you manage to keep voice at a healthy state, because a lot of singers, they lose their voice.
That is the greatest question ever, and I have to be completely honest. I am the most undisciplined person that you will ever meet, because I love to laugh. My husband is very funny, and I do everything wrong. I laugh with my whole body. I'm very loud, and they say that if you're going to really protect your voice, that you have to sort of speak higher, and that protects the vocal cords. But I sound ridiculous, so I won't do that. But there are techniques. I do warm up, especially the older I get. I have to warm up, and there are apps that you can get online to do a little warm up and a cool down if you've done a particularly long concert. Tours are very hard for me because and then you have to do interviews. They like to do interviews before the concert. And so it's exhausting. And you're talking all the time. So yeah, by the end, I'm pretty trashed by the end of a tour. So also being quiet is a good idea. Just if you can, just don't talk for a day between a gig or whatever. And rest is very, very important. But warming up is crucial if you're a singer. Yeah. I have a very favorite song that I performed my entire life. It's a Spanish song that's a classic, and it's done with mariachi usually, and I don't do it in that way at all. You can go onto Spotify and listen to this, because it really is a gorgeous song called Cucurucucu Paloma, which is, the mariachis have sung it forever, and it's a story about a little bird who came to sing to this man who thought he was dying of a broken heart, and the bird sang to him that it's good that you feel so deeply. If you didn't, you just may as well be made out of stone. And I sing this song all over the world, no matter what else I'm singing. I add this at the end. Everybody responds to this song. So that is kind of the magic of music. I sing in Spanish. A lot of people don't speak Spanish, but they just hear it and know that there's something really special about that song.
At what point did you realize that?
At what point in my life did I realize that music was what I wanted to do? my whole life. I remember being a little tiny kid and going camping with my family and being among the trees alone and just singing to the trees and saying, yeah, this is what I'm meant to do. Although, I have to say, I had lots of other interests, you know? Like, I had a job doing photography. I could do so many things because as a kid, I was taught how to be, you know, Mexican. I'm from Afro-Mexican, Hungarian, Jewish stock. My mom wasn't going to let me get away with saying no about anything. I could run the record store when I was 10 years old. I could rewire a refrigerator when I was 15. I mean, you just somebody says, oh, can you do this, and you do it. Or you learn how. And that was before internet, too, by the way.
Yeah.
You guys are, yeah, kind of lazy with this internet thing. But music, but you know, choosing it and then getting to do it, like those are kind of different things, right? And I remember Leonard telling me when I was thinking after this tour we did that was so long, and I thought, wow, this is exhausting. I don't know that I am cut out for this, and I was young. I was like, this is a lot of work. And I thought, well, maybe I could do something else. And I said to Leonard, you know, maybe I could choose something other than this kind of a career, because this is hard. This is really hard on the body. It's hard on everything. And he said, darling, you don't choose it. It chooses you. And that's kind of what happened.
You said that your dad, like, didn't want you to fly. So, like, how did your parents react when you kind of, like, made that, like, firm decision of taking the route of music?
Thanks for asking that, because I got, and maybe this made me a stronger person, I got zero support from the family. And when I got a vocal teacher who was this wonderful classical teacher who taught me about everything, he taught me about life, he was wonderful. And I would talk to my mother and say things like, you know, well, you know, do you think that, you know, Reagan is right to do this kind of pulling funding from this or that? And I would just, she's like, who are you? She said, taking those voice lessons, that's ruining you. Because my mother believed anybody that was the president, whether he be a Republican or a Democrat or anything, the president is right. Because both my parents were immigrants. So to be here in this country, they were just like, whoever the president is, he's right. And I'm like, no, we have to question him. And my mother said, you're getting uppity. I'm canceling all of your voice lessons because you're becoming a little obnoxious. I said, great, I'll get a job and I'll pay for them myself. So I got no support from my parents. My father, you know, he was a failed singer. He was a terrible alcoholic, not a good father, not a good husband to my mom. And it made me stronger. And I left home when I was 16. So at that point, I felt, you know, I got a job, I rented a room. And I pursued my career and, you know, stayed away from drugs and alcohol, and I just was on my own, so I knew that I had to pretty much be responsible for myself, and I was going to take care of myself. And of course, having an alcoholic as a parent, you will also learn what not to do. And being in the music business for as long as I have, I've seen how alcohol and drugs don't help anybody. So it's a rough life.
How does having an alcoholic as a father, my grandfather is an alcoholic, so I know a lot of the family patterns. How did that affect how you raised your children?
Oh, that's fabulous. I went to adult children of alcoholics the minute I could. I realized there was a support place for someone like me, because at the time I was very judgy about alcoholics. I was very, very, and almost like a lot of anger still towards them, right? So so getting help, getting a little therapy, going to meetings, having friends who were recovering alcoholics, I think also, I realized that it's a disease and that it's still very difficult to have an alcoholic in your life, it's always going to be difficult. So, and being a musician, we know lots of them, so they're in our lives. Whether it's hard or not, they're there. With my daughter, we didn't make it taboo. I always said, if you, because you're going to want to know about the stuff, I'm sorry, you just are going to want to know. So if you're going to drink, if you're going to try some drugs or whatever, I would like to know about it. And I will always be there if you need me. Like if you need me to pick you up, if you need me to take you to the hospital, whatever you need. We didn't make it taboo in our house. And because my husband is a wonderful chef and we've always had meals together, that's also super important, is that you are bound by this time that you spend together around the dinner table. Always having conversation. My daughter trusted us. And if she wanted to taste a glass of wine, not a problem. It was never like, ah, you're not drinking. And then everyone gets to college and it's this crazy free-for-all. You know. And funnily enough, she did get to college and we did get that call about, okay, Mom, I went to a party last night and I have to say, I have a hangover today. And I just said, oh my God, I'm sorry, it's disgusting, I know. And she said, well, and it also, it was very bad wine. It wasn't the good stuff. She was used to having good wine with us, and yeah, and I think that though did it. I mean, she's even now, our daughter's almost 30 now, she's an amazing human being. And married happily with a wonderful husband and great job. And you know, after the holidays, she was like, yeah, you know, I really don't need to have a glass of wine every night, but I just don't. People think they do, but so you do it. But parenting, I think being open and about everything is the good way to go. It's the right way to go.
I've got a question.
Yes. Husband of mine. Yes.
All the things you've done, all the places you've gone, what if there's one thing you absolutely must do that you haven't done, what would that be?
Oh, wow. Sing on Broadway, maybe? That I haven't done yet.
We'll work on it.
That would be fun. I'm a terrible actor, but maybe we could work on that. That'd be fun.
Do you have like a Lucky Charm you drink with you, or like some sort of
You know, do I?
You used to, before a concert, listen to Tony Bennett.
Right. I did that for a long, long time. But you know what? This last concert after COVID was particularly stressful for me. So I listened to Foray's Requiem, which is so beautiful. There it is right now. No. Anyway, I think, is our time up?
That was the time.
I think it is.
No.
Thank you so much, everybody.
Thank you.